Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 70 for the 12th of February, 2023. A quick shout out to YouTuber Grandma Funk. No, you don't want your cats actually working on the sewing machines. They get hair in everything. Isn't that right, Gracie? Yeah, you're a good girl. It was an awful busy week here. I managed to get some work done in the shop, as well as doing an inordinate amount of work at the day gig, and even got a night of hatchet throwing in with the league. So yeah, it's been a good week. Woohoo! I got a box in the mail from my good friend Carol, who lives out on the West Coast. Actually, get this down to my lap. And Carol sent me stuff to work on. She sent, let's see what we have here. This is broken brush caps, it says. So, oh yeah, there's a motor there, another motor. I love working on these. I think this is the one that she originally wanted me to just do a couple things on. I'm going to go through all of these. I told her when she was sending stuff for her 201, send me the balance wheel. So here's a balance wheel. Let's see what's this. Ooh, another motor. She said she was sending a few extra things. And here's a motor that's missing some parts. And let's see what else we have here. Get the box out of the way. And, ooh, she uses the fancy ones with the Ziplocs. With the things, and this is a light assembly with an LED that's going to get rewired. And what's in this one? This should be power block with a switch, hopefully. Power block with a switch. All right. Wow. Carol, you sent me four. Woohoo! I know she told me what was wrong with them. Well, this one's obvious. Some of these are missing bobbin winder things, but that's okay. I know she tried getting some of these armature assemblies out, and she wasn't able to. So, wiring's lovely on that. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to start with this one, because I believe this is the machine, motor that she was originally wanting to have some service work done on. This one looks like some of it's been done, but I'm going to rewire that, or at least reshrink that. And rewire this. Let's see what's going on with this thing. Well, we'll figure all these out as we go. Anyway, let me get reorganized, and we'll start digging into this. This is just going to be like a benchside chat type thing. Before we go too far in getting into Carol's motors and stuff, viewer Valery had sent me an email the other day, and I responded to it today. I had sent her drawings and stuff. She's interested in making one of my fixtures, and I did mention that I have not created a drawing yet that shows how I made my little machinist jack. And those of you who are real welders are going to look at the welds on this and laugh and or be horrified. But I just want to go through what I used to make the jack. The jack works just fine. The process I used to make it. The threaded rod, what size is that? That looks like that's 5/8. 5/8 inch rod and a matching nut. I cut it down. This is a piece of, what's that? The thickness of that. Roughly 1/8 of an inch thick. is it? Yeah, roughly eighth of an inch thick, 1 inch wide stock that I bent into a U shape, kind of a U shape. And then, prior to bending, I welded the piece, if you want to call that welding. This is really embarrassing, the lousy quality of my welds, but it's strong. It's not going to go anywhere. It's welded in the middle. And then I did heat this with a map gas torch to help bend this into a U shape. And then I took another piece of the same 1 inch wide stock. I drilled an appropriate clearance hole and then welded the nut on the back of it. So this forms a essentially the height adjuster. And then there's a piece of tube that's 5/8 inner diameter that's welded to a piece of, what is this, 3 inches? Yeah, it's 3 inch. It took a piece of 3 inch flat, 3 inch flat stock that's, roughly 1/8 of an inch thick. Made a little 3 inch square, kinda, and welded the tube on there. And then that just goes in, and this is adjustable for height this way. This now becomes a jack, a screw jack. And to protect the surface of the sewing machines, while I'm working on them, all I do is I take one of these terry cloth towels that I buy in a big pack. Let me see if I got a pack here I can show you. Yeah, here's the package. These are the Grant's terry towels, 14 by 16. I get these at Harbor Freight. They're not expensive. It's 12 in a pack. Anyway, I just use one of these. I fold it over and I drape it in, so that when the machine head is sitting in here, the terry cloth towel is protecting the machine head. I will make a drawing for this eventually. Valery, I apologize for not having one at this point. I did send you an email with the dimensions and the all the sources for the material for the fixture itself. I will recommend, however, not recommend, it is required when you're using that fixture, it's got to be secured to the bench. And that's why I have a piece of T-track that runs pretty much the length of my bench. It's in one of the videos that I had linked, and I use these clamps that go into the T-track, and that holds down the fixture. If you don't do that, you're risking having that machine going flying, so it literally can fall off, the whole fixture can come off the table. It has to be clamped down. That's why I don't expect too many people to make these things, because you really do have to have a piece of T-track in the bench. Anyway, enough of that. Let's get on to working on Carol's motors. Okay, I just got off the phone with Carol, and we were talking about what's what on these. This one motor that looks really nice, I'm just going to add some lubricant to that. This she's already worked on. She just wanted me to go over it and make sure it was okay. I will be rewiring the light and the switch, and I will be doing a cleaning and lubrication on the balance wheel. You see that the Textilite gear is kind of being sluggish, so that's going to need a cleaning. This particular motor is off of a 15-91, and it needs the full treatment. It's got a lot of issues of its own. The word from Carol was that these, the 201 is off of her 201, but the rest of these motors are off machines that she is cleaning up, and she's going to be donating to a charity out in the Redmond, Washington area. So I'm like, awesome, we'll work on this and we'll get this done for you. So I've got it, today is Friday, it is almost 5 in the afternoon. I want to get these in the mail tomorrow morning. So anyway, this one has sheared off brush caps. And for those of you who have never removed one of these sheared off brush caps, I'm going to show you how I do it. I take a little blazer torch, it's a butane powered torch, and I heat up a screwdriver tip. Oh, you're not seeing that, are you? There we go. I just heat up a screwdriver tip. You don't have to get it super hot, just hot enough that you can stick the screwdriver in. There, that worked there. And there we go. We can unscrew the sheared off head, extract the brush. I've got another method that I'm going to use, and I will demonstrate. So, in the center, there we go. And now, we've got a little hole. Now it will come out. There we go. That broke it through just enough. And out comes the bad cap. Ta-da. Caps like that get thrown because guess what? They don't get any better in storage. So, go ahead and we'll take this the rest of the way apart. Yeah, Carol is a very prolific quilter. Very talented, very prolific quilter. As many of you are, I can name a half a dozen of you who are very talented and prolific at quilters. That means you, Joe. Anyway, actually, I don't want to take that off just yet. I got distracted. All right, we're going to remove a few more parts here. This one doesn't want to come off. There we go. This motor is filthy. So, go ahead and get these screws loose. So this motor can be like me, with a screw or two loose. Screwdriver for these. There we go. All right. That's not wanting to come out. So, let me grab the appropriate hardware is out. There we go. Nice and grungy. And, disgusting. All right, we'll continue the dissection. Okay. This last screw off. She did not send the bobbin winder with this, which is okay. And I'm just going to cut this off because why not? Okay, and And out that comes. And you can see, this is gross. So, cut this vomit grommet out. I'm gonna go ahead and get some of the crud out of here initially before taking this to the sink. So, I broke my rule and I don't have an apron on, so after I come back from the sink, I will put one on. Right now I'm just wiping crap onto a napkin on my lap, which is probably not the smartest thing I've ever done in my life. But I just want to get the majority of the crud out of here. It is a veritable schmoo fest inside this motor. Ooh, like snot on a doorknob, as my dad used to say. All right. Get some of this, more of this crap out of here before it goes to the sink. All right, kids, I'm off to the sink. I'll be back in a minute. See, that's the schmoo that came out. All right, I'm going to resume work on this motor. I get ready to do the rewire. The original wires on this were not in as bad a shape as you might have thought. The insulation is still quite supple. Problem, of course, is none of this stuff lasts forever. So let's get this stripped back a bit. There we go. Actually, I can use the actual stripper on this one. All right. I've shown this many, many times. But I'm going to show it once more because I understand not everybody is a long-time viewer. And if I say, oh, go back to find video, blah, blah, I realize a lot of people just aren't going to do it. So, you know, it's not a big deal. The wire I use is this stuff from Stinger. It's the Stinger Select SSPW18BK. It's 18 gauge black wire. It's 18 gauge is more than enough for the low current draw. I am very generous with the wire compared to what Stinger was. So, actually, I was way too generous when I pulled that off. So what I do is I strip off at least an inch on this. I just left this in one long length. You'll see why in a moment. Wind it nice and tight. And then, while I've got it here, I'm going to take it and wrap it around nice and tight here, get a good coil going around the end that I had already stripped. I'm going to leave it just like that for the moment. I'm not pulling out my fancy soldering iron. I'm just going to use a Weller gun, basically being a little lazy at the moment. Get some heat going. And let me grab my cleaner here. Clean the tip off a little bit. Don't breathe this in when you're doing it. But anyway, I'm going to actually apply a little bit there just to tin it. apply the heat to the joint, not to the solder, and then just touch the solder to it. That way you don't get way too much on there. Bada bing, bada boom. And then I'll trim off the excess here. Ouch, that's a little warm. Duh. And then we will lather, rinse, repeat, and do exactly the same to the other side. And then we're going to come back and we're going to shrink wrap that. Once again, wrapping that nice and tight. I'll push that off to the side. Okay, that's good. And apply some heat. And the solder will flow to the heat. There we go. That's more than enough. Not too much. We'll trim that off. Bada bing, bada boom. Get rid of the debris. Now, I have to get out of camera shot for a second as I have to reach up. I keep all of my shrink tubing suspended over my bench out of reach, out of camera shot. So let me grab what I need. I buy it in the long rolls from McMaster Car, which might not be the least expensive way of buying it. Meaning McMaster Car isn't the least expensive ways to get it, but they deliver quickly. And quick service is worth more than a dollar or two in my book. Okay, now I'm going to measure out a little bit. We'll take about there. For that one, slip that on nice and straight. Up, over, come on, get over it. Sometimes, if you've made a mess of your soldering or your wrapping, it gets too big, you can kind of crush it down. So I'm going to kind of crush that solder down a little bit. There it goes. And that extends across both parts. And I'm going to use my little Schneider. Butane torch. And that shrinks my shrink tubing quite nicely. I stopped using my big electric heat gun a while ago in favor of that little butane torch from Schneider. I had originally bought one of those little, it's actually can be used as a soldering iron, can be used as a heat gun, you know, blah, blah, blah. I saw it over at Harbor Freight. I'm like, let me give that a try. And I bought it initially thinking, I could use this in my field kit. That way I don't have to worry about blowing circuit breakers because my heat gun's really, really powerful. And if you don't have, you know, if you have something else on that circuit, it can do a number on circuit breakers or pop circuits. So I figured, this would be great for just doing this on, you know, in the field. And I liked it so much, I bought a couple more of them. I've got one in my field kit, I've got one on my bench, and I've got a spare. And these are great. They're not that expensive. They run on regular, you know, cigarette lighter butane. It's awesome stuff. Okay, that is back together. That's going to be done thusly. And I've got to put some measure of strain relief on that. And the measure of strain relief I'm going to use is going to be a small zip tie. I'll be right back. Now, what I'm going to do first before I do anything else, I've got a larger piece of shrink tubing here. I'm going to take my two pieces of 18 gauge, run the shrink tubing all the way up to where it's going to be going inside the machine. I get that nice and tight there. I'm going to take my gun, my little propane thing again. I'm going to shrink this down. And what this does is it gives you a very close approximation to the look, anyway, of the original material that Singer had used, the original two-conductor wire that Singer had used when they made these things back in the day. Now, I know a lot of people rewire these motors and they use 16 gauge wire. I think that's perfectly fine. And normally I am a proponent of there's no killing like overkilling. But with 16 gauge, you really can't duplicate like this, which you can do with 18 gauge. And really, 18 gauge wire can handle a tremendous amount of current. I mean, tremendous is a relative term, of course. I mean, we're not talking tremendous amounts of current here. You know, this is what, a 0.7 amp motor? You can definitely pass that through at 120 volts. So, that's why I do it this way. Yes, I have had people criticize me for it, and no, I don't care. I'm told it's wasteful, it's too expensive. I'm told a lot of things. And my feeling is, if you're not paying the bill, don't complain about the way I do it. If you're one of my customers and you complain, I'll listen to you. But if you're just complaining just to the sake of complaining, I don't really care. All right. Sticking that on rather than tying an underwriter's knot. That's a perfectly legitimate way of doing that. Now, the common way people do their grommets is to use the large size ones. I stopped using those a while ago. I now use that size. Got a much smaller hole. Same size grommet, goes in the same hole, but it's a much smaller hole. I'll put a link down below to the ones that I get from McMaster Car. But using the smaller diameter wire and packaging the leads up the way I do with the shrink tube makes for it works really, really well with this size grommet, and then more importantly, it looks good. Works good, looks good. And let's make sure the grommet's all the way through. There we go. Give her a little swirly. She does the swirly. Okay, so I start feeding the wire through there. All right, so we got the wire started through the grommet. So while we're in that mode, before we go any farther, I'm going to go ahead and put the brush tubes back in the brush holders. I think I mentioned that this is going into a machine that Carol is donating to a children's hospital out there. So, one good donation deserves another. She's not getting a bill for any of this. Not if it's going to charity. So, but then again, there we go. Get the excess off of there real quick. Okay. Alrighty. And pull that through. There we go. And out the hole. Marvelous. Now when we look down, we don't have any wires that are going to get in the way of the rotating mass of the motor. That's always the first thing you want to check. The last thing you need is something banging up against the rotating mass, because that's just going to make a mess. We'll get some screws going to hold the field coil back in. Okay, line up. Line up. There they go. And this one's going in. Okay. The worst of that mess is done. That looks good. Bravo. Okay, next up, I'm going to clean this mess. All right, let me get these commutator bars cleaned up. Okay, rotating mass has been cleaned. The bars are polished. There is a deep gouge in there. Nothing I can do about that without taking off a tremendous amount of material. And then I flushed it with the quick drying contact cleaner to make sure any of the metal from the rotating mass was removed. Make sure the gears wiped down. It's looking good. All right, now my trick for getting the gear in, like I said, a lot of you have seen this already. And if you have, I expect that you've probably already left. I'm figuring that the people who are hanging out at this point have never seen me do this or never seen it done. I've probably done 6 or 7 of these on camera already. But I put the worm in between the, or struggle to get the worm in between the bushings. If it'll cooperate, just get it into position. And it's dropped in lower than it needs to be. And then I use a small screwdriver, get it down there. Oh, you're going to make a jerk out of me now, aren't you? Okay, supporting the worm supported on the screwdriver. You'll note that there's a flat on the back end here, and I'll point it out a little bit better. On the back end of the rotating mass, in the back of the shaft, there's this little flat here. That corresponds with where the flat is on the shaft where the set screw has to go. So, go ahead and juggle that. Gets that lined up. I put that like in about the 10 or 11 o'clock position. And then I just rotate the worm. You can feel it when you're hitting the flat. You can feel when you found it. Crank the first one on, swing it around. Crank the second one on. I just realized I didn't show you was, yes, the little plastic washer was in fact on the end of the rotating mass. I didn't show it, I'm sorry. I should have. We'll look at it in another one another time. Okay, so that's in. Boom, boom, boom. Now I'm going to take a brush. You'll note how the brushes wear because they're up against a curved surface, so they're going to wear with a little bit of a concavity. Make sure the concavity is facing in the same direction that the to match the curvature of the rotating mass, the commutator bars. Now, this machine needs some brush caps. Actually, a bunch of that's wrong size brush caps. Hold on, I got a bunch of brush caps here. That's a brush cap. And we're going to put new brush caps on this because this is the one that we had to cut the old brush caps off. So. Just get her started. There we go. Started. Thing about brush caps, never crank them. Just get them on and firm. Once again, get that curvature to match. Curvature matches. Let's see. Just push that down. There we go. And we're going to apply some power to this thing just to make sure that we got a working motor here, which I have all the confidence in the world we do. And if we don't, I got some splaining to do. Come on, get on there. Oh, I grabbed the wrong size brush cap. Duh. They're not all sorted. I have a rather large collection of parts here. And I don't necessarily have the brush caps sorted by motor type. I know I have enough. This is the right one. And that's the correct one. I have all sorts of motor parts in there. There we go. Okay, let me throw a temporary plug on this, and I'll bring back and we'll start this motor up. Okay, I've got the ends terminated, so we're onto the power block. Now, I have not put any grease on the gears yet, and I have not put the grease wicks in. I just want to make sure that, number one, I did not screw anything up and that the motor is going to run, and number two, that the motor is going to turn in the correct direction. If I did this right, the motor will turn in such a way that it would be slinging the grease towards the back plate of the case. So, let's see. Oh, helps to plug it in. Let's see how we did. Oh, that's correct. I'm not getting electrocuted. So we're in good shape. So that's good. Next step is going to be getting the lubrication system in, and actually, let me get the soldering gun out of the way here. We'll get the lubrication system in and get her all buttoned up. Okay, I cleaned up that as best as it's going to clean, and I'm going to start the reassembly of the body. Like I said, I haven't put the have not put the grease wicks in yet. That's okay. That can be the last things that we do, is put the grease wicks and everything back together. Been having a discussion with Liz as to what we're going to do for dinner tonight, and we've pretty much come into the fact that it's going to be Chinese takeout. So, once I get these grease wicks in, I'm going to take a little break, go to the Wame kitchen in Port Monmouth, and get some delicious takeout. That's too big of a screwdriver. So that side is good. That's good. And make sure I get the excess off of that. Okay. Excess off of that. All right. You might have, those with sharp vision might have noticed that there was an extra couple of retaining clips here. That's actually for one of these other motors that where they're missing. I pulled them out when I was speaking with Carol on the phone. And initially she had sent me those saying, well, you can have them as parts. But knowing what she's doing and the number of machines that she's trying to push through for the children's hospital, I'm like, no, I'm gonna do those for you, and that way you've got them for those projects. And when you come across something that needs a motor, you'll already have one in stock. She already procured different motors for the machines that those came off of. But I'm going to fix them anyway and send them back out to her. All right, packed a little grease in with that. And that's a foolish move on my part because I cannot feel that. And in there, you get the spring underneath where it belongs. And slide that down. Oops, spring underneath. Okay. That's in. Let's take a palette knife of grease. Trowel it in there. It's not quite coming through the other side yet. These little artist palette knives are really handy for troweling grease. As you can see, I decanted some of the special grease that I really like into, so I'm not bringing that big 5-pound tin up anymore. So it's nice to be able to just use a palette knife and just trowel it in and then put a finger on and force it down into the hole. Okay. Something to clean that up. Cap on, then we'll do the one in the front. Always do the more difficult one first. The one in the front's easy to get to. There we go. Now, actually, that is a little long. It in, stuff it in the hole, and get the clip on there. Use this to screw it down, and that'll force it in. Okay, the clip is now down where it belongs, and we'll just pack in the grease. Yes, this is disgusting. That's okay. I don't mind disgusting. Okay. Yeah, it's plenty. Close that up. This will force it down the rest of the way. Yep, I got a nice little bed of it forming in there. Let's throw a little bit more in on the main gear. Alrighty. Put the end cap on. And this motor is ready to ship. What I've got left to do, I've got not one but two balance wheels. Carol sent me a balance wheel in our conversation. Turns out that she has a broken balance wheel on the 1591. And she was originally thinking she could put a spoked wheel on it. I'm like, not on a 91 you don't, because it won't have the textilite gear that's necessary to engage into the motor. And she's like, oh crap, that's right. So I told her I would look through my stock, and I found this extremely disgusting one. So we'll clean this up and send that to her as well. So anyway, at the moment, I'm going to take a little break. Liz and I are going to go pick up some Chinese takeout. And after dinner, I'll be back, and we will continue the march on taking care of Carol's stuff for Children's Hospital. So there you go. On that note, we're going to leave it for the moment. When we come back, dinner will have been consumed. Next on our hit parade tonight is going to be this lamp assembly from a 201-2 that Carol sent. Now, these lamps can be a bit of a challenge sometimes to get apart. There we go. Screw cracked loose. This isn't in that bad a shape, but I'm going to replace this anyway, because these are old. I don't know how old the sewing machine is, but they haven't made 201-2s in a long, long time. So, rather than have the thrift shop at Children's Hospital selling something that we don't know is 100% safe, we're going to make sure it's 100% safe. Just like when I do something for my favorite local charity, the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association, everything gets redone, rewired. Okay. Thing to look at here, the contacts. These are, they're pretty grungy. So, I'm going to take steps to clean them a little bit. I'm going to use one of the Scotch-Brite type pads on the rotary tool to clean the corrosion. Now, while this is still attached, I'm going to take this to the buffing wheel and just polish those ends a little bit. Okay, those are considerably cleaner now. So, let's get this stuff out of the way. And I'll grab a third hand. We're going to need that. I'm just going to trim, I'm just going to cut this off pretty much flush here. And we'll strip out the, we're going to save that. And like I said, I'm a little bit more generous with the wire than Singer ever was. So, let me get things organized here. First order of business is going to be to clean off the old connectors, clean the connectors off. We're going to do that. Some heat, actually. Yep, get that out of the way. I've got some solder wick handy, and I want a desoldering tool. Okay. So, here we go. Let me zoom in on that a little bit. Okay. Hopefully you guys will be able to see what I'm doing here. Okay, that came off. And we'll take soldering wick. Okay. That get it all? Yeah, it looks pretty good. Let's get the other one. Hotsy botsy. By the way, touching that straight out of the soldering gun, not the smartest thing I've ever done in my life. Okie doke. Actually, put that in there a little bit better. Use wick on it from here on out. Okay. How's that looking? That looks good. Now, rather than burn myself, set that aside. Okay, now we need to get that thusly. This is another tool that I've had for an incredibly long period of time, this third hand. I believe I've had this particular one since, might be as long ago as the 1970s. And I'm going to line this up. And, oops, that's a little long for what we need, so I'm going to trim that down just a skosh. There we go. There we go, that's one side. Actually, while that's cooling off, I'm going to go ahead and desolder the wire from the switch. If you hear rumblings in the background, that is Roscoe chasing Grace Slick. And he's being a brat tonight. For some reason, he's extremely jealous of Gracie. And he can be rather mean to her. He is, as we like to say, being a brat boy. Get the crap off there. I have an incredibly long piece of wire here that I'm going to just go ahead and use for the switch wire. I'll trim it down later. It's entirely too long. But that's okay. Like I said, we'll trim it before we put the connector on the other end. Come on, get in there. Get in there. All right. We don't need this around here anymore. This has served its purpose. Okay. All right, so here we go. We're going to insert the two ends. Just come through. It's important to remember to put the felt washer back in, because if you don't, you can have serious, serious issues with the light fixture itself. So don't ignore it, don't lose it, don't forget about it. Use it, put it back in. that's in. We will retighten the screw, the set screw that locks in the... There we go. This, by the way, many times this sheathing, because it's like an asphalt-like coating, can get really, really nasty. This particular one did not do that, which I'm rather surprised. I very rarely see that stuff where it's not in horrible, horrible shape. So it was quite pleasantly surprised by that. Okay. So let me grab another underneath three of these. Like I said, I'm a little bit more generous with the wire than Singer ever was. And just to make it easier to wire the bloody things back up. And I'm hearing Liz on the phone. So we're going to go ahead, trim that a reasonable length. We're going to need about that much shrink tube. I'll get the switch done first. Okay, there we go. And we'll put that over there. Squeeze her up. And we'll do all the shrinking of the shrink tube when we get everything assembled. It's about the same. Yeah. There we go. Okay. And by the way, dinner tonight from the Wame Kitchen in Port Monmouth, New Jersey was awesome. I'm a huge fan of Chinese takeout. And, Wame Kitchen, the family that runs that place, they've been running it for a long, long time, well over 20 years, and it's always good. It's consistently good, and I can honestly say it's one of the best, if not the best. It's at least in the... I screwed that up. It's at least in the top 10 of all Chinese takeout places I've ever been to. And I eat a lot of Chinese takeout. All right. It's certainly better than any place I ever was in Massachusetts. Being a native New Yorker, I was horrified when we moved to Massachusetts, and the first Chinese restaurant we went to, and we used to go to a lot of Chinese restaurants in New York and in Massachusetts, the first one we went to, they put a basket with loaves of Italian bread on the table. I'm like, where are we? All right, let's shrink this tubing down. This one. And this, when we get this done, we'll put the switch back in the power block. And then this will be ready to make its way, or at least these first two motors will be ready to make their way home. I spoke with Carol earlier. I had hoped to be able to get all four motors back home, but that's not going to happen tomorrow. So discretion being the better part of valor, what the battle plan is tomorrow morning at whatever time, this particular motor and these first two motors and the one that she sent that I just had to lubricate, plus the one I just rewired, and this light assembly and two balance wheels will be going back. Like I said, she was missing a balance wheel. She had one that the balance wheel is broken, and fortuitously, I collect a lot of junk. Not junk, I collect a lot of parts, let me rephrase that. And I happen to have one. And like I said, it's going to a good cause. Oops, I need the 5/8. What's wrong with me? And where's my 5/8? 9/16. Is it 9/16 or 5/8? 9/16. There we go. My brain's not working. It's late. All right, so that's together. Now all that's left for this order that's going out is take these two balance wheels apart and service them. And they're, well, this one's the one that originally, that she sent. It's not too bad. This one is filthy. So let's get these apart. We'll take the filthiest one apart first. And honestly, I don't remember where I got this one. I'm in a stage of my life where I'm collecting parts and collecting machines that are parts machines. I don't necessarily need to be collecting parts. I'll go back a little wider here. And there we go. The important part about getting these clean. Oh, that came off nice. Get this old grease out of here. Get fresh lubricant in it. Because there's this spring inside that's backwards. It looks backwards. Hold on. Let me take the second one apart, too. Ugh, this one feels gross. Get that out of the way. This feels gross. These were both going to go to the sink anyway and just get degreased. Because God knows they need to be degreased. But the only thing that's not going to go to the sink is the screws. But, that kind of preamp. That's coming. Ugh, that's gross. Yeah. Okay. It's not backwards. All right. And we'll pull this out. This one just wasn't working because the old grease is just so nasty. And let's get some of these tools out of the way that we don't need at the moment. And needle nose, pull those out. Pull. Come on. And pull that out. That one, and oops. And that one. All right. I'm going to take some stuff to the sink and clean it. I'll be right back. All right, we're back. We've got all our pieces clean. And I'm going to go ahead and reassemble these two. It's not hard, but I'll walk you through it. First thing we're going to do is put the pins back in. And pins are in place. This spring here is a shock absorbing spring. Now I'm going to take a little bit of grease, pack a little bit of grease in around the shock absorbing spring. Not much, just a little. Around the pins and around the spring. The grease here is mostly going to keep this somewhat quiet. How quiet it's actually going to be, these things never really get super loud. So, and we put the separation plate on. And it goes in the hull. And we take the Textilite gear, and that goes into the spring. Oh, look at that. That's springing back much nicer than it was before. Why? Because this is much cleaner than it was before. It's amazing how cleanliness improves everything. All right, I'm going to start off by getting the screws started in the retaining ring. I've really come to like this particular screw starter set. Actually, all the screw starters that I've been using, I'm really enjoying having. They're making my life a lot easier, and I know it's making it a lot easier for you guys to see what the heck I'm doing. Now, as far as spacing goes, we're supposed to be getting about 3/1000ths of an inch or so. I'm going to use a thickness of a razor blade here, just as the basis. First side. And then I'm going to swing it around, stick the razor blade under over here. Oops, I did went too far on that, didn't I? The razor blade over there. Just on there. Actually, let's get a more appropriate screwdriver. And let's see how the spring action is. Much, much better. Okay, that's good. So, do we dare try sticking the other one together? Of course we do! Wrong screwdriver. Tighten these up a little bit. Now I'm going to be sending some appropriate lubrication materials to Carol that I'm going to want her to put just a touch on those on the Textilite gear, but I'm not going to put it on the gear in transit. Not when I've got two of these balance wheels to send at the same time. There we go, we got both of the pins in. I'll do this a little differently. I'm going to put a little bit on the outside surface like this. This is probably the best way of doing it, is just put a light coat on the outside like that. Put it on. Oops, it's a little bit much. That's more than enough. And we'll put the spacer plate on and the Textilite gear. Oops, not in the hole. There we go, that's in the hole. All right. That's critically important, by the way, is to get the pin on the Textilite gear into the hole on the spring. It's kind of the whole point of the operation. But Okay, let's get that in place. This one does not want to go on as nicely. There it goes. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to flip that over. It's not sticking through. All right. There. Stick a razor blade under that side. And a razor blade under that side. That's actually a little bit more clearance than what the service manual calls for. But I find they snap back really nice when you set them like this. And they're still not too noisy. So I'm more concerned with having the snap back action, which takes stress off of the mechanism, which is the whole purpose of having that shock-absorbing spring inside a balance mechanism. And there we go. Perfecto mundo. All right. Two cleaned up balance wheels. Now it's time to pack up this box and send it all back to Carol tomorrow morning. I will never get tired of rewiring those potted motors from Singer. They're so much fun to do. Did I honestly just say that? Well, they're not bad. And I like doing the 201s lighting units as well. So, yeah, it's all good. So, anyway, that's what I've got for you this week. We're almost done on Sophie. Next episode on Sophie, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be taking apart her bobbin winder assembly, cleaning and polishing that, putting her back together. And then we're going to dig in and do all of the little nitpicky final adjustments that need to be done on Sophie before she can go up for sale, and the proceeds of which will go to charity. I might as well tell you now, the charity is going to be the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association. They're up the road from us up in Leonardo. I've mentioned them many times before. I've done work for machines for them for their thrift store. And that's where the proceeds from Sophie is going to go, is to that organization. They do great work. Anyway, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next video.